Hello, and welcome to our program, Astronomy for Everyone. The topic for this month's show is the New Horizons Pluto Update. And with me here in the studio to bring us this interesting information is our own Stephen Witte. Hi, Stephen.
Hi, Don. Thanks for bringing me back here. Always good to be here.
Good. So why don't we take a moment to recap some basic things about Pluto before we move into the latest information.
Okay. So Pluto was discovered in January of 1930, and about a month later, it was announced to the public. Pluto goes around the sun in about 248 years. So since 1930, Pluto has made it about a third of the way around its orbit. So it hasn't made it around once. Pluto's diameter is 2,374 kilometers. For reference, Earth's moon is 3,476 kilometers. So Pluto is about 68% of the size of Earth's moon. Now, you might think, oh, well, that makes Pluto a smaller object, and it is. But in Pluto's defense, if Earth's moon were orbiting instead of the Earth and the moon, we would call it a planet, I'm pretty sure. In any case, Pluto is quite bright. It reflects about somewhere between about half and about two-thirds of the light that strikes it from the sun. So when it was first discovered, they thought that, oh, it had a darker surface, and therefore it must be much, much larger. In fact, they thought it was five times the size of the Earth when it was first discovered. But now we know it is much smaller and not nearly as heavy. So we now know, because of the moon Charon, which was discovered in the 70s, we know the mass of Pluto and Charon both together. There's some interesting math that you can do to get that, discovered by Newton. We know that due to its density, we know its size, we know its mass, so we know its density, 70% of Pluto is the core of Pluto, whatever the core is. And then it is surrounded by a water ice mantle. It is possible that there is still radioactivity from the core, radioactive materials in the formation that may be heating the core, and there may in fact be a liquid sort of ocean between the core and the rock mantle. And
Do we have any information any more than that, or do they think we might find some additional information to support that?
We certainly haven't discovered this yet. We haven't proven this one way or the other yet, but it's a possibility.
Oh, okay.
There are two other bodies in the system that have a surface that is not exactly coupled. They can float around over the core. One is Titan, and that was discovered by the Cassini mission orbiting Saturn using radar. They discovered that the radar maps don't line up. And that's because the surface on Titan gets moved around at maybe like 13 to 25 kilometers an hour.
That's quite a bit.
It is really quite a bit. And when Cassini went around Saturn and occasionally did a radar map of Titan, the surface had moved between mappings, and so you couldn't quite line. If you had two radar maps that crossed, that would be fine. But then if you had a third, it might not be possible to line up the third with the other two. So that was kind of interesting. Anyway, and the other body in the solar system where the surface moves, gets pushed around by the wind, is the Earth. It doesn't get pushed around a lot, but we have a molten
magma
between the core and the solid core and the surface, and the wind actually pushes it around just a little bit. And this is something different from the continental drift. So this first image of Pluto, the colors come from the Ralph instrument, and the Ralph instrument it's an imager, but it also does infrared spectrometry, and there are a number of colors. There are quite a few colors in the infrared, and scientists have chosen interesting colors to map to red, green, and blue. So, for example, this darker reddish region to the lower left, the Cthulhu region, we're looking at methane for the most part, methane coating over things, and they've chosen these darker colors for that. The blues up above, I think, are indicating water ice. The white region, the heart, this is the Sputnik planum, very flat plane. This is nitrogen ice.
Okay. So we have a number of different elements present as ices in this cold environment.
That's right. And that first little bit is typical of Pluto. Pluto has lots of surprises. It's more complex than you expect. Pluto is quite a bit out from the sun. It's quite cold. It only gets up to maybe 45 degrees Kelvin. And that's, okay. That's in the heat of the summer. In 1989, we had the closest approach of Pluto to the sun, and it has been going farther away from the sun since then. And yet it's warming up in those periods, which we'll get to. It's been doing lots of weird things, and we're just not expecting that kind of change in a body so cold.
Okay.
So... very little about Pluto was expected. It's really pretty interesting.
The next image, is there...
So we have the other side of Pluto. So we don't have as much resolution on this side. This is the side that faces Charon. The New Horizons spacecraft was about a week away from the Pluto-Charon system. It turns out that the rotation of Pluto and Charon and the orbit of Charon around Pluto are all the same. They're both tide-locked with each other, and it's about 6.5 Earth days. So
For Pluto to make one complete rotation on its axis?
That's right. Okay. So in order to see the other side, you had to be farther... New Horizons had to be farther away from than the closest approach.
Okay.
So... after New Horizons went past the Pluto-Charon system, it was behind both Charon at one point, and that's what this image is about, and we were looking at around the edges of Charon at the sun, and we were looking to see if there was any atmosphere, and we were using the ALICE instrument. The ALICE instrument is like Ralph, only it's an imager, plus it is... ultraviolet spectrometry.
Okay.
And this turns out to be better for looking at atmospheres and analyzing atmospheres. Now, we don't have, at this point, all of the data back from this experiment, but we haven't detected any kind of atmosphere. This image here talks about the atmosphere of Pluto, and it turns out that the bottom is Pluto's surface, the red at the bottom, and then there are two distinct layers in the Pluto atmosphere, so up to 31 miles and then up to 52 miles. The next image talks about, is an image of this atmosphere of Pluto. In the upper right, you can see a little white section, and that's a reflection of the surface of Sputnik Planum. And the rest of it is primarily just the atmosphere.
We're seeing this image with Pluto being backlit by the sun. That's what
right.
illuminating the
exactly.
atmosphere.
Okay. Exactly.
Okay.
So, and then the next image, we're talking about the pressure. Now we knew about this before New Horizons because it only goes up to about present. But down in 1989, that first. Dot, we've got 5 there, and then toward the top we have like 18 or 19. The pressure on Pluto has been going higher. Now, I thought this was millibars, thousandths of an Earth atmosphere density. These are microbars. These are millionths of of an Earth atmosphere.
Yeah. Okay.
And it turns out that 1/1,000,000th of an Earth atmosphere is a decent laboratory vacuum. We are not talking about a lot of atmosphere here. It's mostly nitrogen. And the
nitrogen that hasn't frozen out.
That's right, yeah. But there is some methane and some carbon dioxide and ethane and even acetylene.
Oh, my.
All kinds
of weird things. Don't light a match, right?
Well, there's no oxygen.
Well,
so,
there you go. Okay.
Yeah. The next image we have is basically a day on Pluto. We have
a bunch of images.
And at the 3 o'clock position, we have the more distant and lower resolution images. And at the bottom, the 6 o'clock position, we have the highest resolution images. But basically, we've got most of Pluto imaged.
All right. Well, this has been a really interesting presentation so far, but we're going to have to take a break here to bring you Term of the Month. Before we do that, we want to be able to show you our email address if you have a question that you would like to send us about anything on the show or maybe the suggestion of a topic for a future show. You can see the email down there at the bottom of your screen. And right after Stephen finishes up with Term of the Month, we'll be back with more on this discussion of the New Horizons Pluto update.
Thanks, Don. The Term of the Month for April 2016 is gravitational waves. In February of 2016, the LIGO collaboration announced that gravitational waves had been detected for the very first time in history. The event happened in September of 2015, and two black holes merged. They were over a billion light years away. And one of the black holes was 29 solar masses, and the other was 36 solar masses. The two combined in about a quarter of a second, and the event released 50 times the energy of all of the stars in the observable universe for that brief period. This opens up gravitational waves as a telescope concept, which should allow us to learn many new things. That's the Term of the Month for April 2016. Back to you, Don.
Thanks, Stephen. Welcome back to our show. We're going to continue on with our presentation of the latest information on the New Horizons Pluto mission. And Stephen, I think next we're going to talk about Pluto's largest moon.
That's right. So we had one day of Pluto, several Plutos. Well, we'll start with one day of Charon. So we have a bunch of images of Charon. And here, the 9 o'clock position, so that's on the left, that's where the more distant images are. So those are the lower resolution images. And the closest images, the high resolution images, are at the top, at the 12 o'clock position, and sort of moving into the 3 o'clock position. So we'll see some of those features in the bigger picture, which is next. So here is Charon. We expected to see a pretty featureless moon for Charon, and instead we have a canyon that goes across the middle, all the way across. In fact, on the left side of Charon, it continues. This canyon is like 1,000 miles long. You can think of this like Valles Marineris on Mars. It's almost that large. It's that deep. It's certainly way deeper than the Grand Canyon and so on. It's magnificent. We also have, you can see some dark shading up at the top. That's a methane-rich area. And we have other little cracks, and you have craters from asteroid hits. Just lots of stuff. There's even a, just on the right side, at maybe the 230 position, there is a crater that has a mountain in it, but it is not a central peak of a crater. It's a real mountain that has nothing to do, as far as we know, about the... It looks more like a mountain with a moat around it. What's that about? We don't even know. It's just awesome. There are also things that look like river valleys on Charon. Well, like who knows?
You couldn't imagine some of this stuff.
Yeah, we weren't expecting any of this, and so we've got some work to do on Charon.
Great. Well, do we have any more information on some of the other moons of Pluto?
Let's go on to Nix. Nix is about 12 miles by 29 miles. So the long way is 29 miles across. So you can see that there are craters on it. So we have some sort of cratering history. You can even see craters on craters. So you get some... and you've got weathered craters. So you've got very old craters, and you've got... sharper, more well-defined craters that even overlap them. So you have old ones and new ones. So you've got actually quite a bit of information on this fairly tiny moon. So this is nothing like the size of Charon. Next is Kerberos. And Kerberos, here we didn't get as good a shot just because of the geometry of the flyby. This is maybe 7.4 miles across by 2.8 miles the short way, and you can see that it is double lobed, sort of like the
comet 67P.
That's right,
exactly.
67P that Rosetta is still circling and looking at. So it has this weird double lobe effect. It might be two objects glued together, or like the comet, it actually might have been one bigger object, and we've gotten some weird weathering going on.
Yeah.
Who knows?
Mm-hmm.
We'll see what the scientists think really happened there. And then we have a portrait, a family portrait of the moons. Now, at the bottom, we have Charon, which is so much bigger than any of the other moons. So we just show kind of a horizon of that. And then we have in sort of order in their orbits. So Charon is the closest to Pluto, and then Styx, it spins fairly slowly. We know its spin rate. Nix, which is one of the two big ones, Nix and Hydra are about the same size. Nix spins in the opposite direction that it orbits. Everything else, so like Charon and Pluto are tidally locked. They face each other, and so their spin direction and rate are the same as Charon's orbit around Pluto. And if you think of that spinning direction, that would be the normal spinning direction for objects around Pluto, but Nix spins the opposite way for no apparent reason.
Perhaps a captured Kuiper Belt object?
We don't think so. We think that all of these moons, Charon and the smaller ones, all formed in some sort of big impact event with Pluto, sort of like the Earth's moon is thought to have formed from an impact.
Exactly.
Of an even bigger scale. And then back to the portrait. So Kerberos is one of the smaller ones. It spins fairly slowly. And then Hydra, furthest out, it spins really fast. It is phenomenally fast. It just sort of spins like a top. And scientists aren't even sure why it stays together, why it even hangs together. Gravitational tides should have slowed it down by now if we had, if this was an event from way back in Pluto's history, but not so much. Hydra isn't listening.
Well, hopefully we'll get some additional information down the road and be able to explain some of these anomalies.
Yeah. So next we move to Pluto's surface, and we have some interesting stuff on Pluto's surface. So we have the full image on the left, and we've got just sort of like a cutout, and then we have the same cutout twice. And the middle strip there is Ralph data. So this is infrared data, and specifically methane data. And you can see that there are bright patches here, and these bright patches correspond to the tops of mountains. Now these mountains are the size of the Rockies Mountains. So they're like 2 to 3 miles tall. And only the tops are bright of these mountains. And so what's going on there, we think, is that we have methane ice, maybe a methane ice frost just on the tops of mountains. So apparently the mountains are a little colder at the top when they're higher in the atmosphere, despite the fact that the atmosphere is a decent vacuum. It's colder at the top than down below, and that's enough to give you a frost at the top and not lower down. And then on the right, on the far right, there's an ultraviolet image, and this corroborates that it's methane ice, and the temperatures and pressures are such that methane would be a gas lower down, so we don't have methane gas, methane ice on the surface, on the tops. So the next image we taught, it was described as a bite out of Pluto. So now this is in the sort of the upper left of the big, if you imagine the big Pluto, and in the upper left of the Cthulhu region, the big red region at the in the lower part of Pluto. So what we have is we have these mesas. And we have a big cliff series, right, diagonally in the lower left of this thing. And periplanitia is the lower section. And what we think is going on here is that we've got a fault line. What we think is happening here is that we have methane sublimating, and it is eroding this area. For some reason, this area is eroding, and the Ralph and Alice information on the right supports this idea. We also have a fissure of the Inner Fossa, which extends all the way from here to Sputnik Planum. It's 370 miles long. It's pretty cool. So then at the edge of Sputnik Planum, we have the chaos region.
And ooh, interesting.
This is so Sputnik Planum is on the right, and it has these cells of nitrogen, solid nitrogen, sort of like I think of it as a nitrogen sand or something. It's kind of weird. But we have these chunks of rock that are the size of Rocky Mountains. They're 2 to 3 miles long, right up against the edge here. And what we think is happening is that the methane has sublimated out, it has left a big chunk of ice water rock, the size of a Rocky Mountain, maybe bigger. And what happens is that solid nitrogen is heavier, is denser than solid ice. And so these big mountains sort of float on solid nitrogen, and they float east across Sputnik Planum. It's pretty wild.
Out of this world.
It really is out of this world, and you can kind of see how it happens.
Is that pretty much what we've got then for our latest updated information from the New Horizons mission?
That's about all we have time for. As we were going to press for this show, 40 new papers were delivered at a conference, and we're essentially not covering them. We just have little snippets here where we allude to some of them.
So it sounds like that would be a great lead-in for a show later this year or early next.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
All right. Well, I want to thank my guest, Stephen Whitty, one of our crew members, for being with us here today to talk about this latest information that we've been able to receive from the New Horizons spacecraft. You can always go to the NASA website, nasa.gov, and then check the missions tab at the top to find some newer information. Of course, don't forget to check out our club website. The address is down there at the bottom of your screen, as always. And coming up next will be Stephen again with What's Up in the Night Sky. We appreciate you watching this interesting show. Stay tuned for Stephen. We'll see you next time.
What's up in the night sky for April 2016? Now, we've just had our equinox in March, and the days are still getting longer, although they're getting longer a little slower now that we're past the equinox. The sun rises at 7:15 at the beginning of the month and 6:30 in the morning at the end of the month. This is, of course, Michigan time with its bizarre time zones and everything. It sets at 8 p.m. and by the end of the month, 8:30 p.m. So rises earlier and sets later as the month goes on. The moon, the month starts with a new moon on the 7th, first quarter on the 13th, full moon on the 21st. We'll mention that again, and third quarter on the 29th. Mercury. I actually looked all over the month for a good spot to show you Mercury, but Stellarium puts a tree right where Mercury is, down in the lower right there. But on the 18th, we have the greatest eastern elongation of Mercury, so it should be the highest in the sky on the 18th. So Mercury starts at the month setting at 8:45. And at the end of the month, it because the eastern elongation is toward the end of the month, it actually sets later at 9:27. Jupiter had its opposition in March, and it's a little east of south. And here on the 18th again, the moon happens to be fairly close to Jupiter. Jupiter is pretty bright, and so it's easy to spot anyway. It sets at 6:26 in the morning at the beginning of the month and 4:27 at the end of the month. So it's really getting to be more of an evening object. Pluto, Saturn, and Mars are in this field of view. Now, this is not a good enough view of Pluto to find it. You'll need a much better sky chart. Pluto rises at 3:27 in the morning, so it's a morning. These are all morning things. Again, around due south. Saturn rises at 1:15 in the morning, and by the end of the month, it rises at 11:12 p.m. Saturn has its opposition coming up in June. That's only a little bit over a month. And then finally, Mars rises at just after midnight, at 35 minutes after midnight at the beginning of the month, and 11:45 at the end of the month. So we have just a couple interesting tidbits. We have on April 6th, we have a double transit of Jupiter. Look at the Sky and Telescope magazine for details, 11:45 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And then on the 21st and 22nd, we have the Lyrid meteor shower, but there is a full moon that is going to make it difficult to spot a lot of meteors. And that is what's up in the night sky for the month of April, 2016.